Good morning, all of you. In the previous class, we discussed about direction to expert system, some advantages and disadvantages, right? So in today's class, we'll discuss about phases in building expert systems, which is how to build an expert system, right? So coming to the phases in building expert systems, the first phase is here, identify the problem domain. That means, what is the problem? First, we have to identify what is the problem. So that is the first phase, identify the problem domain. Second step is design the system. Now, based on the problem domain, we need to design the system. Okay. Next, develop the prototype. That means now we have to develop the prototype. That means which type of a language you have to use, like that, right? Next. So, next one, test and refine. So, we need to test and we have to verify whether that particular prototype is working correctly or not. Next one is develop and complete the expert system. So based on the testing, we need to, if there are any additions, then we need to add those things and we need to complete the expert system. Now, maintain the system. Now we need to maintain the system. So these are the six phases in building expert systems. Now let us see one by one. So first one is identify the problem domain. Okay, identify the problem domain. So first one, the problem must be suitable for an expert system to solve it. That means, so we need to see whether that particular expert system is able to solve the problem or not. Okay, so the problem must be suitable for an expert system to solve it. Next, second one is find the experts in task domain for the expert system project. Now I have to find the experts in the task domain. That means so first of all I need to identify all the experts. That means who are experts in that particular task domain, and we need to find the experts in that particular task domain in order to do the expert system project. Next one, establish cost effectiveness of the system. Now we need to see whether that particular expert system is cost effective or not. That means we have to design the expert system in a way so that it should be designed in less cost. Okay, so it doesn't overcome our budget. Okay, so within the budget it has to be done, right? So we need to search for that thing. So establish cost effectiveness of the system. Next, second one is design the system. So based on the problem domain, we need to design the system. So first of all, we have to identify the expert system technology, the which type of technology we need to use. Next one, know and establish the degree of integration with the other systems and databases. So we need to identify, or we need to know, or we need to establish the degree of integration. That means we need to integrate this particular expert system to other systems and to other databases. So we need to search for that thing. That means whether integration can be done in an easy way or not, right? Next one, realize how the concepts can represent the domain knowledge best. Okay, that means whatever concepts we use here, those should represent the domain knowledge. So those should represent the domain knowledge in a best way. Next one, develop the prototype. Now we need to develop the prototype. That means we need to acquire the domain knowledge. Okay, so from the knowledge base, the knowledge engineer works to acquire the domain knowledge from the expert, represent it in the form of if then else rules. Okay, that means we need to use the language here. So which type of language you need to integrate here, right? Next one, acquiring the domain knowledge. Next one is test and refine the prototype. Now we need to test the expert system, whether it is working in an effective way or not. So the knowledge engineer uses sample cases to test the prototype for any deficiencies in the performance. That means the knowledge engineer will test the expert system if there are any deficiencies in the performance. So if there is any deficiency, then he need to rectify it, right? So test and refine the prototype. Next one, end users test the prototypes of the embedded system. That means it will be given to end users. Okay, end users means it will be given to various number of persons. Okay, and they will test that thing. Okay, next one is develop and complete the expert system. Okay, test and ensure the interaction of the embedded system with all elements of its environment, including end users, databases, and other information. That means, so we need to once again test whether it is working in every condition or not. Okay, so if that is over, then if everything is working well, then document the expert system project well and train the user to use the expert system. Now we need to document it and we need to train the user to use the expert system. Next, last one, maintain the system. Okay, maintain the system means if any error occurs, then we need to rectify it in future, right? So keep the knowledge base up to date by regular review and update. So we need to review it regularly and we need to update it. Next one, cater for new interfaces with other information systems as those systems evolve. So cater for new interfaces with other information systems. That means that should be connected with the other information systems, okay, and we have to check whether it is working well or not. That is nothing but maintenance. Now let us see what the difference between a traditional system and expert system. Traditional system and expert system. Okay. So coming to the expert system, the entire problem related expertise is encoded in data structures only, not in programs. That means everything will be encoded in data structures. Okay. But there won't be anything in programs, right? Next, coming to traditional system, problem expertise is encoded in both program and data structure. That means it uses both the program and data structures. Here only encoding will be done only in the data structures, right? Next, coming to the second difference, in an expert system, the use of knowledge is vital. Okay. Whereas in traditional system, data is used more efficiently than knowledge. Okay, here use of knowledge is more. Here, data usage is more rather than knowledge. Right. Next one, in expert system, they are capable of explaining how a particular conclusion is reached and why requested information is needed during a process. That means explanation can be done easily here. That means why it has occurred, so it can explain everything, right? Whereas in traditional system, they are not capable of explaining a particular conclusion for a problem. These systems try to solve in a straightforward manner. That means the traditional systems won't have the capability of explaining a particular thing. That means why it has occurred like this, so it cannot explain. Whereas expert system is able to explain everything, why that particular conclusion has come there, right? Next one. Coming to the problems, solving the problems. Problems are solved more efficiently in expert system, whereas in traditional system, it is not as efficient as an expert system. Next, coming to expert system, it uses the symbolic representation for knowledge. Okay, here we use symbolic representation. That is, symbolic representation is nothing but rules. Next one, frames. Next, semantic nets, scripts, all these will be used here. It means symbols. Using the symbols, it will be represented. Whereas in traditional system, they are unable to express in the symbols. They just simplify the problems in a straightforward manner and are incapable to express the how, why questions. That means it doesn't explain how this is being happening and how why this is being happening like that, right? Whereas here, expert system, it can explain everything. Next, coming to the next difference, problem-solving tools are present in the expert system. Whereas in traditional system, there won't be any problem-solving tools. Next, solution of problem is more accurate in expert system. That means solving a problem is more accurate. Whereas in traditional system, solution of problem is not that much accurate. Okay. Next, so in expert system, it provides a clear separation of knowledge from its processing. That means processing is different, and knowledge is different here. Whereas in traditional system, it doesn't separate the knowledge from the control structure to process the knowledge. Next, coming to expert system, it processes the knowledge expressed in the form of rules and use symbolic reasoning to solve the problems in a narrow domain. Okay, so in the form of rules, the knowledge is being represented here. Whereas in a traditional system, it processes the data and use algorithms, a series of well-defined operations to solve general numeric problems. And next, coming to the next difference, reasoning. So permit inexact reasoning and can deal with incomplete, uncertain, and fuzzy data. So you can deal with incomplete data, uncertain data, and fuzzy data, right? Whereas in traditional system, it works only in the problem. So data is complete and exact. That means the data should be complete or the problem should be complete and exact. Then only it can solve the problem, right? Coming to the next difference, expert systems enhances the quality of problem solving by adding new rules or adjusting old ones in the knowledge base. That means every time the older ones will be updated and new rules can be added easily. So that enhances the problem quality, right? So when new knowledge is acquired, changes are easy to accomplish. That means we can easily change the knowledge base here, okay? Whereas coming to traditional system, enhance the quality of problem solving by changing the program code. That means you, whatever we need to change, we can change it only in the program only, right? Which affects both the knowledge and the processing. Here, making changes will be difficult here in traditional system. Whereas in expert system, it is easy. Right? So this is regarding the differences between expert systems and traditional systems, right? Next. Coming to the next topic. Architecture of expert system or components of expert system or rule-based expert systems. The question can be asked like this. Draw the architecture of expert system or explain the architecture or explain the components of expert system. Or explain about a rule-based expert systems like this. So it can be asked in three ways. Either architecture of expert system can be asked, or components of expert system can be asked, or rule-based expert systems can be asked. Three different ways. Okay. Next. So now this is the architecture of expert system, right? This is the architecture of expert system. This is the architecture of expert system. Right, so we have an explanation module, next an inference engine, next we have an IO interface, knowledge base, editor, learning module, working memory, case history file, all this. Okay, so using the IO interface, input will be taken and output will be produced. Okay, next, this particular explanation module is connected with IO interface, right? So this part of IO interface is bidirectional with the inference engine. That means it is used for inference. That means if in order to refer something, it uses the inference engine. Next one, this particular inference engine is connected with knowledge base. So it is also bidirectional. So that means knowledge base is will be updated based on the inference engine. And next one, to the knowledge base, a learning module is connected. So this particular learning module learns everything, or it stores everything, right? Next one, this particular inference engine is also connected with working memory. That means the storage will be there in the working memory, right? Next, inference engine is connected with case history file. That means if any previous cases are there, then they will be stored in the case history file, right? Next, IO interface has the editor. That means if you want to edit anything, that can be edited using editor. Okay. So this is regarding the structure of expert system. Right? Okay. Come to the first one, that is IO interface. So the IO interface permits the user to communicate with the system in a simple way. The IO interface permits the user to communicate with the system in a simple way. So we can connect with the, or we can communicate with the expert system using the IO interface. That means giving the input and getting the output. Okay. Next, come to the next one, that is knowledge base. Knowledge base. So the knowledge base is one of the important components of expert system. So this particular knowledge base contains a set of production rules and facts along with its solutions. That means each and every rules, regulations, facts, all will be stored in the knowledge base, right? Next one. For example, if a student fails to get greater than or equals to 66% in attendance, then declare that student as detained. Okay. So for example, the rule is given like this. Okay. So now the knowledge base will search for it, whether that particular student is failed or passed. So if it gets more than 66% of attendance, then he is passed. Otherwise, he will be failed. Okay. So because the condition is going to does the thing, right? So each and every time the student will be searched for the percentage of attendance, whether he is greater than or equal to 66% or not. If his attendance is greater than or equal to 66%, then he will be passed. Otherwise, he will be failed. Okay. Right. That means this is nothing but promoting a particular student to the next class. So if a student is to be promoted to the next higher class, then he should satisfy this particular percentage of attendance. If that is not satisfied, then the student will be detained. Okay. Next. So next one is inference engine. So this particular inference engine is nothing but the rule interpreter. That means whatever rules we are framing, that will be interpreted by this inference engine, right? So it performs the task of matching, that means matching the rules. Next, from the responses given by the user and the rules. That means it takes responses from the user and applies the rules, right? Next, finally, it picks up a suitable role. That means based on the task performed, it is going to pick up the suitable role. Next one. So the process goes on like this. So knowledge base will be there, working memory will be there. Okay. So from the knowledge base, it gets the rules and facts. Okay. So the working memory, that means from the working memory, it gets the matching things. Okay. Right. So matching things, right? So next one. So after matching the things, it searches for the conflict set. That means if there is any conflict, okay, then that will be searched. Okay. Next, if there is no conflict, then set that particular thing and execute that thing. So like this, each and every matching rules will be stored and executed, right? Next one is explanation module. Next one is explanation module. So this particular explanation module contains answers for the questions of how this particular thing is happening and why this particular thing is happening like that. Right, next one, to respond to a how query. The explanation module traces the chain of rules. That means it tells why that particular thing is happening like that, right? Next one, to respond to a why query, why? So it explains both the how and why, right? So in this particular explanation module, is able to explain why certain information is needed to complete a setup. Okay. Next one is working memory. So this is the storage, right? So these are the one which are handled at the current situation by the system. It's also called as temporary storage. Okay. Next one is case history file. Case history file. So this particular case history file contains all the input and output transactions. Okay, all the input and output transactions are stored in case history file. Next, so this particular case history file contains all the inputs given by the various users and the outputs given by the system based upon the input. Next one is learning module. Okay, so when the data is considered the case history file, then the system performs the learning module. That means if any information is to be updated, then this particular learning module learns that particular thing and stores in it. Next one is editor. So this is used to edit the thing. That is, it is used for insertion or deletion of data in the knowledge base. Okay. So this is regarding architecture of expert system, right? Next one, knowledge acquisition and validation. Knowledge acquisition and validation. So one of the most difficult tasks in building knowledge base is in the acquisition and encoding of requisite domain knowledge. One of the most difficult tasks in building knowledge base is the acquisition and encoding of requisite domain knowledge. Okay, that means the domain expert, he contacts the knowledge engineer, and the knowledge engineer edits the system using the knowledge base. Okay, next one, expert system shell. So the expert system shell So this particular expert system shell is nothing but the it is a shell that is used to have interaction between the expert system and the programming environment. Okay. So this particular shell is used to an easy interface or communication between the expert system and the programming environment. Right. Next. So each expert system that was built from scratch was done by Lisp programming. So yes, so here we use Lisp programming language. Lisp means list programming. LISP means list programming. List programming, programming language. So after several systems have built in this way, it is clear that these systems often use a lot of common things. So here we have an interpreter here. So that interpreter gets the domain specific knowledge and it creates a system that is used to construct new expert system by adding new knowledge, right? First point is the new problem domain. One of the important features that a shell must provide, is an easy way to interface between an expert system and programming environment. So the main use of expert system shell is to have easy interface between the expert system and programming environment. For example, graphical games, right? Next, come to the next topic. This is an example for an expert system called Mycin. Mycin, MYCIN, Mycin. So it is one of the oldest expert systems. Okay. That is developed for medicine purpose. Medicine, right? So it is one of the oldest expert systems that was developed at Stanford University in the year 1970. So it was developed as an expert system that could diagnose and recommend treatment for certain blood infections. So basically, this particular Mycin expert system was designed for treating the blood infections. That means if any blood infection is there in a human being, then that particular expert system will diagnose the blood infection and is going to give the suggestions or recommends, or it diagnoses and recommends the treatment for that particular blood infection. Yes. The main purpose of this particular expert system is to diagnose the disease and recommend the treatment for that particular disease. So that is the use of Mycin expert system, right? Right, so this particular Mycin was developed for exploring the ways in which human experts make guesses on the basis of partial information. That means by getting the information from the human beings, it is going to diagnose the things, which particular disease the human being is suffering with. Suppose a human being is having some symptoms. That means, for example, a human being is having some fever. That means, he's having some diarrhea. He's having some diarrhea, or for example, malaria. Malaria, take the malaria, right? So, for example, consider a person has got malaria disease. Okay, then he goes to a particular doctor. So, he goes to a particular doctor and tells his symptoms that I'm having this much fever. And having the symptoms like this, all this, he's going to tell. So then the doctor diagnoses with which particular disease the patient is being suffering with. Okay, so based on the partial information or some of the symptoms related to a particular disease, the doctor is going to identify the disease of that particular patient. Okay, so in the same way, this Mycin is also an expert system that diagnoses the blood infections, and it is going to recommend the treatment, right? Next, this particular expert system was developed for exploring the ways in which human experts make guesses on the basis of partial information. So, like a human expert guesses something, this also guesses the disease, right? So, in Mycin, the knowledge is represented as a the knowledge is represented as a set of if then rules. So if this particular thing is there, then this is the disease. Like that, it is going to use the if then rules. If then rules. Right. So in myosin, a rule can be written in English as follows. So the rules in myosin are like this, right? If the infection is primary bacteriemia, and the site of the culture is one of the sterile sites, and the suspected portal of entry is the gastrointestinal tract, then there is suggestive evidence of 0 to 7 that infection is bacteroid. That means if this particular thing is happening, or if this particular patient is having these particular symptoms, then it's then it tells us that this particular person is having this particular disease. So based on the symptoms, it is going to identify the disease, right? So here the evidence will be from 0 to 7. Evidence 0 means nothing is there. 1 means slightly. 2 means somewhat more. Like that, if the evidence is 7, it is confirmed. Okay. Right. So the 3 stages of conversion with myosin. The 3 stages of conversion with myosin are. The 3 stages of conversion with myosin are. First stage, initial data regarding the case was gathered to enable the system to come up with a very broad diagnosis. That means information gathering. Next, in the second stage, the questions that are asked to test to speak the hypothesis were more direct in nature. That means questions will be asked. So what symptoms you are having, like that, right? So based on the inputs it has taken from the patient, the diagnosis will be done. So in the final stage, a diagnosis was proposed. Right. So there are some versions in this myosin. So in the first version of myosin, it had a number of problems which are remedied in the later version. Right. In the first version, there are some problems that it cannot rectify. Okay. So whereas in the next version of myosin, they have the problems that are there in the first version of myosin have been rectified in the later version. Right. So one of them was that the rules of domain knowledge were often mixed. That means domain knowledge rules were mixed here in the first version of myosin. Next. So here, e-myosin was the first expert system shell developed from myosin. So this is the first expert system shell that is called e-myosin. So a new expert system called PUFF, P-U-F-F, was developed using e-myosin in the new domain of heart disorders. The next one was PUFF. Okay. So that is used for diagnosing the heart disorder. Next, to train the doctors, the system called neomycin was developed. The system called as neomycin was developed for training the doctors. So which takes them through various sample cases, check their diagnosis, determines whether their conclusions are right, and explains where they went wrong. So all this will be done by the system, right? Next. That means going through sample cases, checking their diagnosis, next determining whether their conclusions are right or not, and explains where they went wrong. So all this will be done by the expert system shell, right? Next. So next topic is blackboard systems. Blackboard systems. So these blackboard systems were first developed in the 1970s to solve complex, difficult, and ill-structured problems in a wide range of application areas. So blackboard systems were first developed in the 1970s to solve complex, difficult, and ill-structured problems in a wide range of application areas. So in order to solve the complex, difficult, and ill-structured problems, these particular blackboard systems were developed in the 1970s, right? Blackboard architecture is a way of representing and controlling the knowledge bases using independent groups of knowledge called knowledge sources that communicate through a data control database called Blackboard. So this particular Blackboard is nothing but the data control database that has a group of independent rules communicated with knowledge bases or knowledge sources. Right. So the main modules of blackboard systems are, there are three main components in there are three main components in the modules of blackboard system. They are knowledge sources, blackboard, and control shell. So coming to the knowledge sources, so here they are connected like this, knowledge sources. So a knowledge source is regarded to be a specialist at solving certain aspect of the overall application and is separate and independent of all other knowledge sources in the blackboard system. That means this is an so this particular knowledge source is specialist in a particular thing. Specialist. Okay. Next, so it obtains the information required by the knowledge source on the blackboard. So it gets the information from the user, right? And next, it proceeds further without any assistance from the other. That means based on its, that means it is independent. That means every solution will be done that by that particular, or that means the problem solving will be done by the knowledge source only. So based on information it got from the user, it is going to proceed further. Okay, next. So it is possible to add additional knowledge sources to the blackboard system and upgrade or even remove existing. That means there's a possibility of adding and removal of knowledge sources, right? Next, each knowledge source is aware of the conditions under which it can contribute toward solving a particular problem. Okay, so this knowledge in problem solving is known as triggering condition. That means so it is aware of the conditions and contributes towards solving a particular problem. That means problem solving will be done by this particular knowledge source only. Next one is blackboard. So this particular blackboard represents a global data repository. That means storage, global data repository and shared data structure available to all knowledge sources. It contains all the raw input data, partial solutions, alternatives, final solutions, control information, communication medium. All these will be stored in the blackboard only. Okay, so the advantage of blackboard system is that it retains the results of problems that have been solved earlier, and thus avoiding the task of recomputing them later. That means each and every problem results is stored in the blackboard only. Okay, next one, control component. So the control shell directs the problem solving process by allowing the knowledge sources to respond to changes made to the blackboard. That means the problem that means the control shell controls everything. That means responding to the changes, that means if any changes are done in the blackboard, then it responds using the control component or control shell. So in the classical blackboard system control approach, the currently executing KSA, that is knowledge source activation, generates the events as it makes changes on the blackboard, right? Next one, the events are ranked and maintained until the executing KSA is completed. That means all the events are ranked and they'll be maintained until the problem solving is done, right? Next. So this is the blackboard system control cycle. Blackboard system control cycle. Okay, blackboard. So the events will be given to the control shell, and the control shell is connected with the KSA activation. So the KSA activation will give the data to the executing KSA activation, where it is connected with all the knowledge sources. Okay, so this is how the control cycle happens in the blackboard system, right? Coming to the issues in blackboard systems for problem solving, there are two issues. One is specialized representation, and another one is fully general representation. Coming to the specialized representation, the knowledge sources may only operate on a few classes of blackboard objects. So it operates only on few classes. Coming to the fully general representation, in this, all aspects of blackboard data are understood by all the knowledge sources. Fully means everything will be understood. Whereas in specialized representation, only few things will be represented or few things can be understood. Coming to the differences between the rule-based system and blackboard system, the majority difference between the blackboard system and rule-based system is that in the size and scope of roles when compared to the size and complexity of knowledge sources. Okay, that means the size and scope of roles are more in a Blackboard system than the rule based system, right? So this is regarding today's class, right? So we'll discuss the remaining topics in the next class. Okay, in the next class we're going to discuss about truth maintenance systems, monotonic and non-monotonic truth maintenance systems, application of expert systems, all this, right? So let me see how many have attended my class. So only 58 members are present today. I don't know why the number is being decreased day by day. Okay. So if you have any doubts, you can ask me. So if nobody's having any doubts, we can end the session. And discuss remaining topics in the next class. Okay, thank you.